to get started. We are streaming, so just a disclaimer, if you don't want to be seen, try to stay outside of this cone. Your voice might be out there too, so don't identify yourself if you don't want to. For people watching at home, we do have a little bit of a live audience here, so maybe some background noise. For anybody who's not already part of this process, I was just going to give a brief rundown of what we're doing today, why we're doing it the way that we are, and then I'm going to get out of the way and have our expert give us a bit of a breakdown of some local criminal justice issues before we move into actually asking questions. So this is part of the endorsement process for the local chapter of DSA. It's a little bit different from some other types of candidate forums and panels. So rather than putting out a general call, what we've done is basically put out a call for people who are asking for endorsement. If they actively approached us for endorsement, we sent out a questionnaire and then did intensive interviews. I think we interviewed each of the candidates for well over an hour. And then finally bring them here. So we're going to try to go a little bit more in depth, right? Typically when you have four or five people for the same position, running for the same position on a panel, we're going to have relatively quick answers. We'd like to have a little bit more of a decompressed format today. The two candidates we have are not running for the same position, but their duties do overlap. So a lot of these questions will bear topicality of both. What we're really looking for is to make sure that our membership, many of whom are hopefully watching or will watch this later at home, will be able to make an informed decision. We as a chapter have been pretty committed to decarceration and limiting the impact of the criminal justice system here in Austin, and this is one of the races where we can do that. But prosecutorial races are complicated. So we want to make sure that people have good information when we do take this to a vote, which will be next Tuesday, and that you all have the chance to ask the questions that you want. If you're watching this at home, there is a link in the Facebook event where you can go to a Google form and submit questions. I'm going to be periodically refreshing the page that has those questions on there, and we'll be kind of bumping them to the top based on topicality, not duplicating questions that have already been asked, and generally not being a troll. And we've also got a poll there for which subject matters to ask, to kind of put priority there. So even if you don't know what questions asked, if you go through the link, you can go, I'd really, really like to hear more about cash bail, or I'd really, really like to hear more about decriminalization of substance, that sort of thing. And that will affect how we run this today. So the first thing we're going to do is have Emily Gerrick come up here. She's with the Texas Fair Defense Project, and we're going to kind of go over the background of what kind of issues, particularly around equity, around criminalization of poverty, and cash bail, there are in Travis County. We got her because I am not an expert, and I don't want to pretend to be one. So we'll have a little bit of background material so we can get better evaluated when we're asking questions later. Thank you.
Staff attorney at the Texas Fair Defense Project. We are a small nonprofit here in Austin. We do criminal justice reform, mostly focusing on issues of poverty and criminal justice. Some of our issue areas include pretrial justice reform, so bail reform. We do work around criminal justice debt, so fines and fees, people going to jail because they can't afford to pay fines and fees, losing their driver's licenses, getting caught in a cycle of debt because of it. And then we also do work on indigent defense. I know that we have worked with some of you in this room on getting a public defender's office here in Travis County, and we've been doing work on decriminalizing homelessness in Austin. I've been doing some of that work with Seneca and some others. And so I've been asked just to give a little bit of background on the criminal justice system. I think that the best place to start, I don't think you can really talk about criminal justice in the United States, where we got to this point without talking about race. One statistic that I think is particularly telling from Michelle Alexander is that there are more black men behind bars or under criminal justice supervision right now than there were black men who were enslaved in 1850. And criminal justice system today evolved directly from slavery. Black codes, convict leasing, Jim Crow laws, and then more recently, the war on drugs, tough on crime, policing that was enforced almost exclusively against people of color in low-income neighborhoods. And one of the big driving forces that got us to this point was prosecutors. And I think that's not just because they hold so much power in the criminal justice system itself, but also being a prosecutor for so long has been seen as a political stepping stone. And the way to get more power, higher office later on, that was sort of the path that people would take. You go to law school, you become a prosecutor, you'd be tough on crime, you have really high conviction rates, then you get elected eventually to a higher office, and you use that exact same philosophy, drawing from your background, to use that same philosophy and get mass incarceration on a political stage. And so the way that you do that job, what they consider to be well, and set yourself up to win those elections, is to get those really high conviction rates, get really high sentences. And most prosecutors are able to say that they have a conviction rate of over 90%. And that's incredibly high. How are they able to get such high conviction rates? I think we can all guess that the reason is not because they just go after really bad, really guilty people. The answer is that they go after poor people, people of color. And I just want to, so I want to give one example, one story from our work. I worked with one woman who, she had just moved to Texas from Florida. And so she had a Florida ID, and she was pulled over, and the officer asked for her ID, she gave it to him, and he arrested her for failure to identify using a false ID. It was a valid ID, it was just a Florida ID. A really clear-cut case, the facts didn't make any sense. Clearly innocent, but she was 9 months pregnant, she couldn't afford bail, and her attorney told her, yeah, the facts in your case are great, clearly you're innocent, but if you want to get out of jail before your baby is born, you're going to have to plead guilty. And so she did, and now she took a plea deal, she got out, she's on probation, she's still on probation to this day, this is years ago, and she is having to pay probation fees, lots of class fees, and it's just completely consumed her life for so long. She now has a criminal record as well, but she has to shows up when there's background checks for employment. She can't afford to pay those probation fees, those class fees, then it's likely that her probation will be revoked and she'll go back to jail. I think that I'm going to butcher a Bryan Stevenson quote right now. He says that in this country, in the criminal justice system, it's much better to be wealthy and guilty than to be poor and innocent. I think that story really shows that. I think if you look anywhere in the criminal justice system, you're going to see that. The bail system in particular, I think one of the things you may glean from that story is just what a role that plays. And the bail system is really how prosecutors are able to keep those incredibly high conviction rates. So let's talk about the Travis County bail system, for example. The bail decisions get made before the person ever sees anybody. So the decisions are not being based on ability to pay like the Constitution requires. Instead, they have hearings that last just a few seconds, and they have already made their decision before they actually see the person in front of them. And it's not at all based on any of the characteristics of the person, and they don't take into consideration whether or not they're able to pay. So if you're wealthy, you're able to pay the bond, get out almost immediately. If you're not and you can't afford to pay the bond, then you're gonna stay in jail. And there are systems set up, they have entire dockets that are based around this principle. So in Travis County, we have what's sometimes called the rocket docket, what's been called the jail reduction docket until very recently. Now it's called the bond review docket, but there hasn't been much bond review done at these dockets. I think the jail reduction docket is probably the best name for it, which is what it was called until very recently. And the reason that it was called the jail reduction docket is because what they would do is they would bring all the people who didn't already pay bail and get out, and they would have this docket for all these misdemeanors, and they would say, all right, you can either take a plea and get out today, or you can stay in jail and fight your case, but you're not going to get to go home to your family. And the vast majority of people will take the plea deal so that they can go home, whether they're guilty or not. Why would they do that? I think that there are a few reasons for this. Even a short time in jail can be really devastating to people's lives. So jail obviously is a terrible place to be. But also, even just a few days in jail has been shown to be very, very destabilizing, especially if you're already living paycheck to paycheck. And all the people that are in jail, these bond review dockets, is because they are living paycheck to paycheck and can't afford the bond. The conditions are very, very bad in jail. Suicide rates in jails versus prisons. Does everyone know the difference between jail and prison? I'm getting a lot of nods, so jail is for short sentences and prison is for long sentences. And jails are typically made up mostly of people who are pretrial, so over 70% in Texas. And suicide rates in jails are 3 times as high as suicide rates in prisons. And jails are chronically overcrowded. It's just not a good place to be. Most people want to get out as soon as possible. And so I think that when it comes to what prosecutors can do, they really, really, what the whole criminal justice system should be doing is pushing for automatic release. We shouldn't be having people in jail just because they can't afford to pay something. That's particularly important for people who are immigrants and are undocumented. They will run in and get an ice hold on people in a matter of hours. So the only way to really prevent that is by automatically releasing people on these low-level misdemeanors. Sort of bad news, but I think that there is good news here, and that is that there's a progressive prosecutor movement right now. And initially, when this started happening, I was actually pretty skeptical, but I think that there's been a lot of actual movement on this, and there's a huge potential for reform. And Texas criminal justice system is bigger than the entire federal system put together. So the potential here in Texas is huge. Getting an actual progressive prosecutor would make a huge difference. I think that local prosecutor races are maybe the most important races that there are. And I would argue that prosecutors have more power than anybody in the entire criminal justice system. More power than judges, more power than police. So I want to talk about a few different things that I think prosecutors can do and that we should push prosecutors to do. One of the things that they have, one of the sources of their power is charging decisions. And I think that there are a lot of crimes that really just shouldn't be crimes and that we shouldn't be charging at all. So some of the more obvious ones that I think a lot of people can agree with, drug possession is a huge cause of incarceration. But I think that there are other things, so prostitution, trespass, public intoxication, crimes that are typically only enforced against homeless people, hot checks, that's when somebody writes a check that bounces, resisting arrest, almost always, a trumped up charge, driving with an invalid license or driving without a license. The vast majority of license suspensions are for non-payment of fines and costs. And people without driver's licenses, often it's because they can't get them because they have holds for not paying fines and costs, or it's because they're undocumented and are literally barred from getting a license. Right now, driving without a valid license the first time is a Class C offense, which comes with fines and costs, which then if you don't pay, you get more driver's license suspensions. Class B, if you get caught driving with a suspended license a second time, that's a jailable offense. Really, those just shouldn't really be charged. There are other charges, failure to ID. You heard that one story, but really should failure to ID be something that you are prosecuting somebody for at all? There's a lot of Class C charges that are poverty crimes, so driving without insurance, public nuisance, all the crimes that are typically only enforced against homeless people. And then finally, I think bond jumping, failure to appear. Most people are not purposely skipping out on court. If you are accused of a crime, they tell you to come to court, you don't get any sort of text reminder, you don't get a phone call. If you make a doctor's appointment these days, a dentist appointment, they give you a haircut appointment. I get text reminders for my haircuts. Like they tell you you have an appointment coming up. They don't do that for the criminal justice system. It's very difficult to get to court. In some places, if you're even 5 minutes late, they'll count that as jumping bond. They'll often keep resetting your case until eventually you get to court. There's no parking, no free parking, and it's just really hard to get there. And I think that there's been a lot of movement on rotating bail funds that show that failure to appear rates are not actually tied to willful bail jumping. Is anyone familiar with rotating bail funds? So those are pots of money that groups have, usually nonprofits or public defender's offices, and they will pay somebody's bail, and then they will keep up with that person, tell them about their court date, and then when the person appears back in court, they get the bail money back, they put it back in the pot. So those are the rotating bail funds. And the appearance rates for those bail funds are as high as 95%. Those are folks who are low income, can't afford to pay, they don't have their own money on the line, and the appearance rates are still 95%. The difference is that somebody is keeping up with them, telling them about their court dates, and that's how you get the high appearance rates. So exact same people, it's not that their purpose is skipping out on court. And so I think that charging people with a new criminal offense for failing to appear really just shouldn't be done given that fact. And people with money generally don't get failure to appear. And so I think that it's also another one of those poverty offenses. I think that another thing that prosecutors should realize and come to terms with is that if they're sending them to prison in Texas, you're sending them to really torture-like conditions. There's been a few lawsuits in Texas about the conditions, including the fact that they don't use air conditioning in many of the units, or most of the units. And solitary confinement is very common, even for really, really low-level infractions. And so I think that there really needs to be a culture change in prosecutors' offices. Right now, somebody's success is measured by the amount of jail time that they can get, high sentences, and prosecutors need to be pushed to use their discretion for good. It needs to be minimal sentences, minimal charging. They should do the lowest charge available and push for really, really low sentences, and shouldn't be using sentencing as a bargaining chip for getting guilty pleas. Another issue that I was told that I had a long time is that, how am I doing on time?
You're doing just fine.
All right, great.
You can easily do another 10 minutes, no problem.
Okay, 10 minutes, okay. Sorry, I was told that I had half an hour and I did not time this, so let's see. So I want to talk about probation. In Texas, there are 251,000 people behind bars, but there are 368,000 people on probation. And probation is really important because there are a lot of people who are choosing jail time over probation in Texas. And the reason that they do this is because there are a lot of restrictions on probation. You take a lot of classes, it's very expensive, you take probation fees, and the chances of getting a technical violation and going back to jail for a longer period of time anyhow is very high, and you're under state control for a very long period of time. So prosecutors should be making it as least restrictive as possible, no fines or necessary classes, and minimal check-ins, and I think that commitment to not revoking people for technical violations meaning that they didn't commit a new crime, and they're just revoking them for missing probation appointments or failing to pay something. Those need to stop. I think that prosecutors should push for early release, because in Texas, you're able to actually get released early from probation after serving only one-third of the probation sentence, but really only wealthy people are being able to take advantage of that. Low-income people are not being released early from probation. I think that the way that you get the culture change that we're talking about is to actually measure success by something else. You can't measure success by the conviction rates or the sentences. You have to measure success by whether or not racial disparities go down, whether prison and jail time goes down, probation goes down, arrests, pretrial detention, all going down, and that should be how you measure your employees' performance in the prosecutor's office. That should be how people move up the ladder. I would also like to talk just a little bit, I'll skip civil asset forfeiture, but y'all should look that up, it's fun. I do want to talk just about how much power I do think that prosecutors have. Again, I think that they are the most powerful actors in the whole system, including more powerful than judges and police officers. Sometimes even progressive prosecutors will say, well, our power is limited. We can't do that much on bail. For instance, the judges are the ones who are making the bail decisions. But prosecutors can, of course, recommend that everybody get personal bond, police restrictive conditions, They can use the power of their office to speak out and push for automatic release on low-level offenses. And if that doesn't happen, if the judges are stubborn and don't want to do that, then they can commit, they can be creative. They're in charge of all of the charging decisions, they're in charge of all of the dismissals, and they can commit to saying that, all right, if you're gonna keep people in jail pre-trial who don't need to be in jail pre-trial, then we're just going to dismiss those cases. And they can put pressure on judges those ways. And then police officers. One thing that some of the progressive prosecutors across the country are doing that has been very effective is they're creating no-call lists, which means that officers who have been shown to be untrustworthy, who have committed offenses or been just acting poorly or been shown to be biased or dishonest, have bad records, but still aren't being held accountable. And we do see a lot of that in Austin. So for example, Austin has the highest rate of officer-involved shootings when there are mental health crises. So the way to hold them accountable is to have these no-call lists and say that we're not gonna call those prosecutors on our cases to testify. And that's a way to really hold police officers accountable, because right now they're not being held accountable at all. And there have been, so far, I believe, 3 prosecutors across the country that have implemented no-call policies. Kimberly Gardner in St. Louis, Larry Krasner in Philadelphia, and then Marilyn Mosby in Baltimore has actually said not only is she not going to call those officers as witnesses, she's also reviewing hundreds of convictions where that have rested on those officers' testimony. So that is something that I think all so-called prosecutors should be doing. It is true that police officers are the ones who are bringing the cases to the prosecutors, and in that sense, they don't have control over what cases are coming to them, but they can decide that they're not going to be bringing cases that are brought by certain officers, and they can decide that they can be creative about it. They are seeing that there are too many arrests for offenses that they should just be citations where they release them. They can decide that they're going to dismiss all those cases until the policy changes. The power to dismiss cases is very, very strong and I think should be used. I'm guessing I'm going to, okay. All right.
If I can get, if I can get my candidates. We've got coming up to the front Dominic Selvera, who is running for the county attorney position, and then Jose Garza, who's running for district attorney. I think we're both should be within the camera field now. Before we get into the submitted questions, a quick capsule summary for both of you of how you would characterize the role of the positions you're running for people who may not be familiar, because in most cities, these two are smashed together into one job. The district attorney first, how would you describe?
Yeah, so the district attorney has jurisdiction over what are known as felony offenses. In our criminal justice system, we separate offenses based on how severe we think they are, how serious we think they are. Typically speaking, felony offenses are considered more serious offenses. They include violent crimes, but they also include drug possession and other the kinds of crimes that Emily was just talking about. There are crimes of poverty and other types of crimes. I think the biggest distinguishing factor is that for felony offenses, more of your liberty is at stake. And what I mean by that is that you can spend more time in jail, and you can higher fines can be levied against you if you are convicted. So those are felony offenses. That's the jurisdiction of the district attorney's office.
And so on the other end, we have the county attorney's office, where their jurisdiction covers misdemeanor cases, which are considered on the lower end. offenses such as theft, assault, assault family violence, DWI, possession of marijuana. Those are some of the more common charges that we see in the county attorney's office. In addition, there's also a civil side to the county attorney's office where we defend lawsuits against the county. We advise the Travis County Commissioner's Court. So it's sort of a dual role, handling misdemeanor criminal offenses and also civil civil issues as well.
All right. Second, could you both give just a brief synopsis of your background prior to deciding to run and how that's influenced your outlook on what you want to get from the race, how that's informed your moral and political stances with regards to this issue?
Well, how rude of me. I don't even think I formally introduced myself. My name is Jose Garza, and as you know, I'm running for district attorney. And I think there are a couple of things I want you to know about my background. The first thing is that I was born on the border and raised in San Antonio, Texas, in an inner city neighborhood where violence was relatively prevalent. I experienced crime as a kid in multiple ways. I started my career, you should also know that I ended up coming to Austin and did my undergrad here, and I'll tell you a little bit about my career, but I started my career down on the border as a public defender, first at the state and then at the federal level, where I had the opportunity to represent people who had been accused of crimes, and where I saw every single day the way our criminal justice system weighs most heavily against working class people and people of color. After that experience, I had the opportunity to work in Washington, D.C. for a congressional committee, and I ended up serving in the Obama administration. I am now, and have been for the last several years, the executive director of an organization here in town called Workers' Defense Project. And in those experiences, both serving as the executive director of Workers' Defense and working in the Obama administration, I learned and have seen firsthand the power that regular people have every single day to change their community, to change their county, and most certainly to change their criminal justice system. And so I come to this race and to this process with a profound level of disappointment and, quite frankly, sadness and hurt and anger about the way our criminal justice system weighs most heavily on working people and people of color, especially here in the most progressive county in the state, in the so-called blueberry in the middle of the tomato soup. And with an enormous amount of optimism of what we deserve, what we are capable of, and what we can all achieve together. And I believe have the most forward-looking, progressive criminal justice system in the country. And I think we can accomplish that together.
So I didn't introduce myself either. Dominic Selvera. My path to becoming a defense attorney was a little bit different. I was born in Austin. I grew up about 20 minutes east of Austin in a small town called Elgin. I graduated from Concordia University in 2002. And after that, I was burnt out, didn't want to crack open another book for a long time. And I was fortunate enough to go work for AT&T. I was a union member for 9 years. I was a union steward where part of my duties were defending my union brothers and sisters when they either got in trouble or they had a grievance that they filed against the company. And so in 2011, spoke with my wife and decided to go to law school. So I enrolled in 2013, graduated in 2016, and I was fortunate to have the opportunity to clerk for a defense attorney while I was in law school because I knew that's what I wanted to do. So passed the bar in November, and immediately with my partner, opened up a defense firm where we began taking indigent clients right off the bat. Right now, since I'm campaigning, we haven't been taking as many indigent clients, although I'm still on the CJA panel in federal court where I still take appointments. A little bit about my background, and it kind of relates to why I'm here today, is that in my senior year of college, I was arrested for DWI. I was arrested, went through the humbling and humiliating experience of that process, and that was my first experience with the criminal justice system. So I'm sitting there in Travis County Jail with no idea what's going on, not knowing how the hell I'm gonna get out. Luckily, I had a friend who could afford to bail me out. So for me personally, what that meant was I was able to go back to work. I was able to finish school. It was my senior year. And it meant I didn't lose my housing. So going through that experience and kind of a feeling that level of helplessness, you know, it just never leaves you. And then to think 19 years later, we still have that same system where your amount of money that you have in your bank determines whether or not you're set free. So it's just something where I decided to run because honestly, I don't have trust in the people who have been county attorney, who are likely to run for county attorney, because all they're doing is talking about change and being progressive. But where are we at? We're in an era of mass incarceration where nothing is changing and it's getting worse, and I just can't sit on the sidelines and let it happen.
All right, so diving into the user submitted ones, and this I think would be applicable to both of you. Could you outline 3 to 5 ways that you would use your prosecutorial discretion on behalf of the most vulnerable and working class members of our society coming through your door?
Sure, absolutely. Well, like I said, I mean, I think we know, you've heard laid out, the facts and statistics are overwhelming on this, that our criminal justice system really burdens and weighs heavily on working people and people of color. So here in Travis County, just to share a little bit of data with you, over 70% of the people sitting in our jail on any given day aren't there because they were convicted of the crime that brought them to jail. They're not sitting there because they've been convicted of a crime. And far too many of them are sitting in our jail because they can't afford to pay bail. Right now, right here in progressive Travis County. Here in Travis County, 9% of our population, more or less, is black, and over 25% of the population of our jail is black. That is just a few examples about the way our criminal justice system, as I said, like really burdens and weighs heavily on working people and people of color. We also know that when it comes to, just for example, to drug offenses, felony drug offenses here in Travis County, that the primary way that people get arrested for drug offenses in Travis County, for felony drug offenses, is through traffic stops. And we know that over 60% of people who are arrested through traffic stops for drug possession are people of color. Yet when you look at the data, who we are as a county, people of color make up like, I don't know, 45%, not half of our population, but that's who our criminal justice system is targeting. And so I think there are several things, several steps that we need to take right away to start to roll back these really harmful impacts on our communities that, by the way, make our communities less safe. They destabilize our neighborhoods and families. They make it harder for people to work and have jobs, make it harder for people to support their families, and quite frankly, have and are destroying generations of families in our community. So I think there are a couple of steps we need to take right away. The first is we have to end the prosecution of particularly low-level drug offenses here in Travis County. And again, I was going to tell you the evidence is clear, but I've also, so many people have experienced struggling with substance use or struggling with substance use in their family. And my family is no different. We have family members, and a family member in particular, who struggles every day with substance use, and I have seen the toll that that takes on their family. And you know what? Putting them in jail isn't going to solve the problem. In fact, the evidence is really clear that for every day a person stays in jail who is struggling with substance use, the likelihood that they will commit another crime goes up. It actually makes us less safe to try to treat substance use as a criminal matter as opposed to the public health crisis that it is. And so the first step I would take is to end the prosecution of drug offenses here in Travis County. That would also have a huge impact on the number of people moving through our jail system and on who moves through our jail system. The second step that I think we need to take is to end the cash bail system that you've heard us talking about so far this evening. And I think there are a couple of ways that you can do that. The first is, there are counties throughout the state where people who've been accused of a crime have a defense lawyer at the moment where their bail is set so that they can advocate for their rights and advocate for, to be released. And Travis County doesn't have that system. And our district attorney's position has essentially been, that's not her problem. It's someone else's problem. But as you've heard so far, the district attorney is one of the most powerful actors in our criminal justice system. So that's one step I think we can take. The district attorney should also be proactively advocating for people to be released unless they pose a danger to our community. And that's simply not happening right now. So those are a couple of steps right off the bat that can be taken and should be taken immediately that would have an enormous impact on the way our criminal justice system weighs on working people and people of color here in Travis County.
So yes, also just to touch a little bit on the bail issue, Jose's absolutely right. What I plan to do if I'm elected is actually put a prosecutor at the point bail is being set, because I don't think it's going to be enough for our office to just say we're requesting zero cash bail. We're going to have a prosecutor there that's actually pushing for it. And hopefully that means that the county's going to pay to have defense counsel present so that we can have both defense counsel and prosecutors demanding and forcing that issue when we're talking about ending cash bail. Really one of the big things that kind of differentiates me from some of the other folks that are running is my livelihood does not depend on being nice to the judges and to the other elected officials in Travis County. So I am going to be more than happy to call out judges when they are continuing the use of cash bail. I mean, that's the only way that we're going to make change. That's the only way that they're going to respond is if they're publicly embarrassed by the system that's going on. A couple of counties have been sued in federal court. We're talking about Harris County, Dallas County. They've gotten great results. And so there's a way that we can change cash bail in Travis County if our elected officials want to. But we see it's clear that they have no interest in changing it. So that's going to be one of the things that's going to be our focal point if I do win election. Secondly, as a defense attorney, I absolutely see a lot of what's wrong with the criminal justice system, at least from the defense end. We're talking about things like a trial tax. If a person, a citizen, wants to exercise their right to go to a jury trial, the pretrial offer that they have on the table disappears. The prosecutors incentivize people to take plea deals. That's just the way it happens. So we're going to get rid of that practice. We're not going to punish people who choose to go to trial. I feel it's unethical, because if we're recommending probation pre-trial, we're going to recommend probation on the back end. There's nothing has changed from point A to point B, except for a person exercising their constitutional right, and it's the absolute right thing to do. One of the other things that is a big problem when we're talking about people who typically don't have a voice are undocumented folks who don't have citizenship. So when we're talking about coming to a solution where we take into account accountability, but also not ruining someone's life to where we have them increase their risk of deportation. We have got to focus on coming to a resolution that doesn't ruin lives, especially when we're talking about misdemeanors. That there's no reason for a misdemeanor offense to cause someone to get deported most of the time from a country that they've been in since they've been an infant. So that's going to be another area that we're going to focus on. And third, and this is in addition to the typical cash bill, we're going to end the war on drugs, we're going to decriminalize sex work. That's one of the things where it's ripe for abuse when you talk about people being arrested and being afraid to report violence to the authorities because of what their profession is. And frankly, it's a labor right. People have a right to work as they see fit. And we're not talking about trafficking. We're talking about a woman or a man's right to choose what they want to do with their body. And we are just not going to prosecute those cases. We're not. So those are some of the areas that I care about.
So both of you really, I think, focused a bit on cash bail. So I wanted to kind of follow up, because for people who might not be familiar, there's a lot of touting of Travis County, particularly last year when there were a bunch of studies comparing us to Tarrant County, and this perception that we kind of already solved the cash bail problem because Travis County makes use of these threat assessments during pretrial services that supposedly move the onus away from your ability to pay onto objective characteristics. And when you read the initial research papers on these things, it makes it sound amazing. But then you look at the numbers, and there's still 70% of the people in jail are there for pretrial detention. So could you both of you give your perception of what's wrong with that as a solution, like the way we're currently trying to solve cash bail?
Well, I mean, let me just say that the assessment tool in Travis County is a part of the problem. And the way it is set up is that it gives too much credence to quite frankly, tardiness, to whether or not people have made it to prior court appearances. And it clearly, I think the data is pretty clear, that the outcomes of the tool are, again, that it weighs most heavily on working class people and people of color. It takes into account whether or not you have a job. And those are things that that punish working class people for being working class. And so I think there is an enormous amount of work we could do to reform the assessment tool. And I think some of the other broader stroke reforms are really important, which is showing up at bail, advocating, just taking the flat out position that a person shouldn't be in custody unless they pose a threat to our community, and otherwise they should be back in our community working, earning to support their family. So I think those tools are flawed and part of the problem. They could be reformed, and I think there are bigger things that we could be doing to end the cash bail system here in Travis County.
And so just to add to that, Travis County does use the PR bond more than Tarrant County and a lot of other counties in Texas. But I think it's misleading because we're talking about some of the worst counties in the country. And just because we utilize a PR bond for a few folks and then Travis County pats themselves on the back, there are still people in Travis County jail that are there because they're poor. It's bail is not supposed to be used as a tool of oppression, but that's what it is. Bail is supposed to be someone guaranteeing that they're going to show up to court. And I think Emily said earlier, you know, the stats are there. If people are released on pretrial, they're going to show up. They just need the opportunity. They need the reminders. And to tie someone's freedom to the amount of money they have, it's just wrong. I mean, there's no getting around it. And the fact that we still have this system baffles me. And you know, I'm really tired of having Travis County pat themselves on the back for giving a few people justice, but not for everyone. I mean, we've got to change it.
So unless more coming later, last cash bail associated question. So somebody in the room had given me a pretty thorough breakdown of how the bond review docket works, and it was kind of frightening. So my understanding is that most people won't have a lawyer, either a prosecutor or a defense attorney, directly involved in the process of setting their bail until they get to bond review court, at which point they've already been in jail for quite some time. And that's usually also the point where they're being offered a plea bargain. So it's essentially as if you have been put in a box for a little while to sweat it out and then get this or go back in the box. What steps can you take to kind of intervene and make that part of the process in particular more just and more equitable?
Well, I think first of all, we have to avoid a process that bottlenecks so late in the process. And again, I think there are a couple of things we can do. One, you know, by ending the prosecution of drug offenses, you're going to cut a huge swath. It is the number one case that our district attorney's office brings every single year. By volume, we are using, far too many of our resources prosecuting drug offenses. And so by simply, you know, Emily alluded to, one of the greatest powers that the district attorney has is to decide what gets charged in the first place. And so by ending the charging of those offenses, you, I think, greatly reduce the number of people entering our criminal justice system in the first place. That's the first thing. The second thing is there are counties across the state who have the district attorney's office review cases and making recommendations about bail at the point of intake, essentially. And so that's a second step that you can take to make sure that we never get to this point where people have been, you know, forced to sit in a box and essentially broken until they have to make this choice. And then the third is, I think there are a range of, the district attorney has the power to come to judges and just say, you know, for these, basically we're asking for people to be released unless they pose a threat to our community. And I would submit to you, I suspect that the judges care what the district attorney's office thinks. And so I think all of those things together can create a system where we're making sure that which you just described doesn't happen here in Travis County.
So at the misdemeanor level, what we want to do is basically have a presumption of pretrial release for all misdemeanor charges. The thing that we have to keep in mind is for offenses like assault, family violence, we have to keep in mind that we have to put protocols in place to where if there's a protective order needed, those things are done at that point. If we can get that done, it makes it a lot easier to streamline the process. And really, for me, it comes down to, are you committed to make it the system right? Because if you've got people in that position who are committed, the process can work a lot better. You look at Larry Krasner in Philadelphia, who led the way with criminal justice reform. I mean, that's that's an example that we should follow, frankly. So,
can I just add one more thing here, which is, you know, one of the first cases I ever tried as a public defender was a young guy on the border who was coming through town. And again, this is Del Rio, Texas. It's a town of like 35,000 people. And he was a truck driver. And he was coming through town and was pulled over on Highway 90 just as he was getting into town. He was riding in the truck with his partner. And they found, I think it was either meth or meth paraphernalia. And we went through, I think by the time we got to trial, it must have taken 4 to 5, this was a long time ago, but I think it was like 4 or 5 months. We took that case to trial because he was adamant what they found wasn't his. He didn't know they were in the truck. And so we tried the case and we won the case. And 5 months later, he was able to leave, but he sat in jail for 5 months waiting to be found not guilty, you know, waiting for the system to say, like, oops, sorry. And that is the process, that is the system that we have right here, you know, in the greatest, most liberal county in the state. But we can change it. It doesn't have to be this way. We don't have to just accept it.
All right, so how would you characterize the way the diversion programs work right now in Travis County? What are the issues with them, and how would you change them? So diversion would basically, cases where we're going to not prosecute in some way or another, right, to refer to some outside program in place of bringing trial, bringing the sentence.
So first of all, at the felony level, I think diversion programs, first of all, are relatively limited. They keep out, by and large, people who have a criminal history. They keep out, they cost money, and they are not cheap. I mean, I think most of these things, when you're all said and done, easily cost $1,000 or more. And again, they condition your success on things that data and science, you know, tell us are often not realistic. For someone who's struggling with substance use, having a court, the government tell you stop using drugs or else just doesn't work. Like that's not how it works. And so our diversion programs, the overwhelming majority of them, are set up to fail people, set up for people to fail. Those are, if you're lucky enough to have the money to get into them in the first place. And so it's just, our diversion programs are just another way here in Travis County that, you know, our criminal justice system is really weighted against working class people. I think we have an opportunity to expand who is eligible for diversion programs, to expand what diversion programs, what kind of offenses have diversion programs associated with them, and to make clear that how much money you have shouldn't determine whether you have access to these programs. So one of the things that we will do when we win this race is eliminate those financial barriers for diversion programs here in Travis County. But right now, as they're currently structured, they're just another way that our system is broken, especially for working class people.
Yes, yeah, so I agree with Jose's sentiments. I mean, we've got to make it more accessible, especially at the misdemeanor level. It can be a tool that can have some great outcomes, but it's got to be tailored for the individual. I think diversion certainly serves a really good purpose in our system, but really what I want to see an option in the county attorney's office is, frankly, restorative justice. I mean, when you're talking about addressing the needs of victims, people who have been harmed, that's got to be an option. Now, there's not, you know, it's not going to apply to every case, but it absolutely has to be an option if we care about helping people. And that should be the goal of the county attorney's office. At the end of the day, we should be judged whether we're a success or not on how many people we helped, not on how many people we convicted, not how many people were in the county jail. Who did we help when we're talking about victims and people who have been accused of crimes? How do we help them to become better people and minimize the harm that's done? I think it's gonna take a lot of buy-in from the county because restorative justice programs are not cheap. It takes buy-in from the community. But if we're not at least talking about it, we're never gonna get there. And so I feel strongly it should be an option. And so, you know, what we've seen from past so-called progressive DAs and county attorneys is when they get in office, they're asking for more money for more prosecutors. That's not going to happen here in Travis County. We're going to ask for more money for services, for restorative justice, for victims, for substance abuse programs. I mean, that's how we help people, not getting more prosecutors. We're going to help people by prosecuting them less and offering alternative options to get better.
So one thing I think probably only one of you would need to answer this one. Both of you mentioned before kind of the impact on the undocumented people that these kind of programs are kind of obliquely mentioned it, and then you know really hammered in the importance of not conditioning these programs on a plea. Could you just draw a quick picture of why that's important for our undocumented populations in particular?
Go ahead. Yes. Yeah, so one of the major problems is when you've got a client who is undocumented and they're considering taking an offer, whether it's deferred adjudication or pretrial diversion, if they make any sort of guilty plea in front of the judge, immigration officials can get a hold of that and use it against them in their deportation proceedings. So any offer or any resolution that we need to make for someone who's undocumented, we're gonna do it outside of the court if we have to. You know, we do it for pretrial diversion. There's no reason we can't do it for people who aren't documented. I mean, that's, but when you talk about helping people, you've gotta do things differently in certain instances. And this is one where we can still keep that balance of holding people accountable and not ruining their lives. I mean, for me, that's a great outcome when we can achieve both of those. And I think minimizing that risk of hurting their chances to get deported, I think that's gotta be the goal.
All right, so moving on to the other actors and the way you have to kind of interact with them, what would your positions or what steps would you take to make sure that you're able to hold other actors in the criminal justice system accountable, such as judges in the county, your line prosecutors, and even the police department?
Well, what to say about that? Look, I mean, I think we've, you know, we've said repeatedly that the prosecutors in our criminal justice system wield immense power. And I think, you know, it's because prosecutors have this little thing called discretion, which, you know, sounds like a legal term, but it's something that every single one of us has experienced. Every one of us has either been pulled over or knows someone who's been pulled over, and an officer says, well, you know, this time I'm going to give you a warning, or maybe you haven't experienced that, but maybe you know someone who has. And so that kind of discretion flows all the way up to the prosecutor's office, and because the prosecutor has ultimate authority over what offenses get charged and what doesn't, the prosecutor has an enormous amount of power to bend the entire criminal justice system in our county towards good. The judge only gets a hold of a case once the prosecutor has decided they're gonna prosecute it. And, my sense, and I think we have seen this in other counties where there are progressive district attorneys who have made real reforms, eventually the police get tired of arresting people that they know the district attorney or prosecutor isn't going to prosecute. It eventually starts to change behavior. And so, I mean, I think just to start with, that tool and that power is incredible, and you know, has incredible capacity to shape how our criminal justice system impacts working class people here in our community.
So one of the first hires I plan on making is a data analyst to basically collect data on what the judges are doing in terms of bail decisions. I think that that data has got to be collected and it's got to be made public so that people can see what their elected judges are doing. I mean, these guys fly under the radar all the time, that they, you know, but the decisions they make affect lives, and people need to know who they're voting for when they go to the ballot box and choose which judge is going to get elected. So I think that's one of the first things. The second thing, and Emily touched on it earlier, is that we are absolutely gonna have a no-call list when it comes to police officers in Travis County. Nothing makes me madder than seeing or hearing a police officer lying on the stand. And not just that, if we get a provable case of perjury, we're gonna prosecute it. I mean, that's just the bottom line. I mean, we're talking about our justice system that needs to be fair for everyone. And when we're talking about holding elected officials accountable, that extends to law enforcement too. I mean, someone's got to do it. I mean, it's gone on, whether or not, you know, we get to a point where, you know, we have to make some sort of change. You know, we just know that something's got to be done to hold officers accountable who lie on the stand. I mean, it's important to make sure that our justice system works the way it's supposed to. I think those are two of the biggest changes that I want to see happen.
All right, so to move, you know, we've talked a lot about nonviolent offenses, right, and the way that they can harm up the system on the front end. On the back end, violent offenses disproportionately make up the growth of mass incarceration, and a large part of that is sentencing. So I think in the 60s, murder one average sentencing was like 6 to 7 years, and I think now it's what, closer to 25 to 40. Meanwhile, we have evidence that people age out of violent behavior pretty quickly. Given that, like, this is probably a little bit trickier of a subject, how would you change the way this office deals with your perspective towards violent offenses?
It's a great question. And I think one of the things that brings me to this race and to do my best to make this change with all of you is the simple idea, the simple notion that every single one of us and every single member of our community is capable of change. And so you just alluded to some of the data. Seneca is absolutely right. In one of the most important indicators that helps us determine from a data perspective whether a person might commit another crime, might commit a crime again, is their age. I'm trying to remember, I'm sure Emily has it at the front of her mind, but I think the age is at, you know, it's something like around 35, that after 35, the likelihood that a person will commit another crime, you know, falls through the floor. And so, you know, we really have to move away from a system where, you know, we're quite frankly using tax dollars to run nursing homes. And so I think there are a couple of steps that we can and should take, again, immediately. One, what I have said, you know, what I will say to the day this campaign is over, and what I will do is to make sure that in our district attorney's office, sentences of 20 years or more are an exception. Again, you know, the data is just overwhelmingly clear that at a certain point in someone's life, they change, and all of us do, and I think we all have to remember that and believe in it and hold on to that and have a system that reflects that. The second thing is that You know, if we win, our office will proactively and aggressively advocate for parole for folks who have demonstrated this change. And we certainly won't oppose parole in instances where we see people making positive steps. So again, I think those are a couple of steps we can take right away to, as you said, address some of the back end that has led to our mass incarceration crisis, certainly here in Texas and across the country.
So on the misdemeanor level, first off, we have to acknowledge that any time spent in jail or prison, it's traumatic. It causes so much trauma to the person. And so at the misdemeanor level, I mean, it's gonna be rare that jail time is even on the table. I mean, that's just, you know, when you think about the harm that's caused by someone sitting in jail, and then you compare that to the misdemeanor case that they may be charged with, that doesn't seem just, that doesn't seem like the punishment fits the crime. So in our office, if any prosecutor wants to recommend jail time, they're gonna have to get approval from the first assistant or myself. That's gonna be one of the rare times that a frontline prosecutor doesn't have discretion on how to handle their cases. I mean, until you've been there or someone you love has been in jail or prison, it's hard to understand the harm it causes to people and to their families. And so, when judges and juries hand down sentences, I think that's one of the areas where it's really hard for people to understand what those decades-long sentences do to people. And so in our office, it's just gonna be, it's gonna be extremely rare if it happens at all.
Can I just make one more point that I forgot, but I think is really important. And that is that, for the last 40 years in this country and definitely in this state, we have been sold a bill of goods about what safety is. I mean, we have been sold this idea that what safety is locking people up, predominantly working class people and people of color, for long, long, long amounts of time. We have been told that that is safety. And what we know is that really what safety is stability, it's a job, it's the ability for people to support themselves and their families, and that's what justice is. And so I think we have to sort of fundamentally reimagine what justice can and should be. And so when you are the victim of a crime, particularly a violent crime, in our current broken criminal justice system, when you seek the justice you deserve, you basically have one option, which is, if you want justice, you have to sort of sign on to send someone away for a really long period of time. And I think there are approaches all over the country that that provide victims with a range of options, with some people refer to it as a menu, to help people find the justice that they deserve and that they're seeking in that individual case. So some offices have experimented with mediated conversations between victims and the people who have been accused of crimes. And there are other approaches, that we think of as restorative justice approaches that allow people who have been victims of crime to find and have justice that don't involve throwing people, locking people up and throwing away the key. So I think that's another important aspect of this.
So that leads into something, hyper-local, and that, I think a lot of people, myself included, don't have a good answer for, and that's around the way that sexual assault is treated both in this county and really throughout the country, where we both have a situation where people who are punished incredibly harshly, but most people just aren't punished and or don't see any redress for the victims or investigation in many cases. So I would ask basically how each of you would characterize what's currently wrong and how you kind of see yourself navigating through the swamp of how to deal with sexual assaults while you're trying to decarcerate.
Yeah, so what is wrong is that our criminal justice system here in Travis County just doesn't reflect our values as a community. And you can see the current values by the way the current office prioritizes their resources and cases. And I also want to be clear that, you know, it feels to some of you like we're making a pivot in this conversation. Like up to this point, we have been talking about criminal justice reform, and now we're talking about the way our system is broken because of how it treats with utter disrespect survivors of sexual assault. And I think what is important to point out is that we have not made a pivot, that we are having the exact same conversation, and that these two failures of our criminal justice system are absolutely linked. We can prioritize violence against women. We can prioritize violent crime, sexual assaults, but we can't do that while we are spending so much of our resources locking people up because they're struggling with substance use, or locking people up because they're poor. In 2018, our district attorney's office prosecuted less than 10% of sexual assault cases brought by local law enforcement to the DA's office. In the same year, our district attorney's office prosecuted well over 40% of drug offenses brought by local prosecutors. I need to get the specific numbers, and don't hold me to this, but when you look at the raw numbers, it's like 30 cases to over 1,000. Those two things aren't separate. We can't do both. So that's the first thing, is that I just want to make the point that to really focus our resources on violent crimes like sexual assault, we can't be spending all of our resources locking people up because they're struggling with substance use or because they're poor. That's number one. The second thing is that, as I alluded to before, in order to really have a system that that prioritizes allowing survivors of sexual assault to have the justice that they seek and that they deserve, we have got to bring a restorative justice approach to this area. I mean, these, the factors that lead to sexual assault in the first place run deep in our communities and are like, I think run deep in our, in what I think is a misogynistic culture here in Travis County and across our country. And so to really address those root problems, we can't just fall back on the same old lock them up and throw away the key approach. It hasn't worked. It's not gonna work if we keep down that path. And then finally, we've just gotta have a district attorney who takes these cases seriously, who treats survivors with dignity and respect, who has the sort of core value that, you know, women should be believed, and that we should have a fair process that gives survivors options. So there is a lot there, and I'm happy to spend a little more time unpacking it, but I think all of these things are deeply interconnected.
Yeah, so in the county attorney's office, we wouldn't handle sexual assaults. Those fall to the DA's office. But I agree with Jose along those same lines that we've got to focus our resources in areas that matter. So we're talking about focusing more on assault, family violence, and not wasting our money on drug cases. I mean, that's just a huge waste of law enforcement resources, of county attorney resources, and resources of the courts. So I think along those same lines, that same issue applies to assaults in our office.
All right, so a few quicker ones. I think you both at least said yes at some point, but just to clarify, Emily had earlier suggested that having essentially a no-call list and actively choosing not to call off officers who had been known to perjure themselves in previous cases, was the best practice? Is that something that both of you think should be implemented in the office?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah, and let me just one more again. I mean, you know, we have to have a system, a criminal justice system, that treats powerful actors the same way it treats working class people and people of color. And right now that is clearly not the case through outcome. And so that is a pretty straightforward way to start to, you know, even the playing field a little bit.
Would both of you be willing to recommend cases for earliest function upon dismissal rather than making folks wait out the statute of limitations?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, that's a no-brainer, absolutely. I
feel like we're in the Viking room.
Under what circumstances, if any, would you try with someone under the age of 21 as an adult, and would you support raising the age to 21?
Yeah, I have said unequivocally that we will not try minors as adults. And again, I mean, the human brain doesn't stop developing until someone is 25 years old. And again, I think we have to come to devising a criminal justice system that, you know, that remembers and holds dear the idea that people are capable of change, and that we should, that every single one of us has a right to develop into the full and total person we can become, before that development is, you know, stymied or shut down by a criminal justice system.
Both of you have made some mention around decriminalization of sex work, and that's something that I don't think I had heard anybody running for elected office say out loud prior to Tiffany Caban. I don't think even Larry Krasner led with that, if I remember correctly. So was there something that recently changed for either of you, or that, you know, kind of brought you there, or is it just now it seems possible?
So one of the questionnaires that I previously filled out asked me specifically about Larry Krasner's memo and how he treats prostitution cases. One of the things that I disagreed with the Krasner memo was that he limited his policy to people who have less than three convictions. And for me, that shouldn't matter. You know, if someone has been convicted of prostitution in an unjust prior county attorney, that has no bearing on the justice that they deserve now. It just doesn't. There's not going to be a limit. Their criminal history is not going to come into play when we're talking about decriminalizing sex work. It's just not, you know. And as a former union steward, it's important to me that people have the right to work and earn a living without getting harassed by police and without having, you know, being shamed for it. I mean, I think it's ridiculous that these cases are being prosecuted.
Yeah, the only thing I'll add to that is, you know, like Dominic, I also come, you know, from a background of working pretty extensively on labor issues. And what I saw on the border, what I see here every single day, is that, you know, we essentially use our criminal justice system here in this country and here in Travis County as a rug. And when our failed economy fails working people, we sweep them under the rug of our criminal justice system. When our failed education system fails working class people, we sweep them under the rug of our criminal justice system. And the same is, you know, goes on and on and on for our broken mental health system, all of it. And so one of the perspectives I bring to this is just, you know, the simple idea that our criminal justice system shouldn't hold working class people back, and that all work has dignity. And I think when you, you know, put those two concepts together, it's a pretty natural place to land.
Finally, both of you have kind of an extensive relationship with social movements, and I'd like to ask what your perception of the role that both your your participation in those social movements, your workers' defense, in the labor movement, Texas Advocate for Justice, and DSA, both your past experience and your idea of what role they will play in Travis County as you're trying to get these reforms and policy agendas through.
So I'll go first. So for me, it's just doing what's right and being aligned with organizations that believe in doing what's right. For me, my arm's not going to have to be twisted to do the right thing when I'm in office. It's going to be a matter of how do we implement it in the most effective way to help the most people. That's going to be the question, not whether if we're going to do it. It's going to be how we do it and how we can do it to the best of our ability. So, I know that certain people will make a big deal out of any alliance with activist groups, but what we're doing is important. I mean, this, it has to be done, because when you look at the history of whether it's women's rights, civil rights, this stuff wasn't given to us. People had to fight for it, people had to bleed for it, and what we're dealing with right now with mass incarceration, we're gonna have to fight to end it, and it starts at the local level. It starts with doing the right thing and trying to help people. And so for me, I don't consider that in any way. It's just how can we get shit done? Really, that's the bottom line.
The Workers Defense Project, which is the organization that I run, that serves as the executive director for, was started almost 20 years ago as a wage theft clinic. It was a place where predominantly undocumented, exclusively low-wage workers came when they had their wages stolen. That means like they went to work, in many cases for weeks, worked hard for weeks, and simply weren't paid, and their employer knew they weren't gonna pay them, and essentially stole their labor from them. That's how Workers Defense Project started. And what Workers Defense has done since it started 20 years ago is to teach people about the power that they have, that although you may be undocumented, although you may be a low-wage worker, that you have the power to win your wages back. When you stand up and fight alongside other working people just like you. And then, what we teach from there is that if you can win your wages back, then, maybe you have the power to change the laws here in Austin. And if you have the power to change the laws here in Austin, maybe you have the power to change the laws in multiple cities across the state. And maybe you even have the power to change our entire state. Our members, who are some of the most vulnerable members of our community, believe deeply in that concept, and don't just believe in it, but live it and put their put their lives and their liberty on the line every single day to prove it. One of the simple things, and I talked about it at the beginning, that seeing the courage of not just Workers Defense Project members, because in the work we do, we work closely alongside grassroots leadership, the labor movement, DSA, on a number of things, whether it was earned paid sick time, Freedom Cities, in policies across the state. What we have seen and what we just believe deeply in is that, if we can build together a movement of hundreds, thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people who, who have had enough with this failed system, who, demand better, that we can win better. But, I think the important thing to keep in mind is that, this part of the process that we're in of completely reimagining and reforming our criminal justice system, this part, the running for office, the trying to get, hopefully work alongside you to get me and Dominic elected, This is the easy part, because the hard part comes afterwards, once we actually win, and the police union and the judges, and, I mean, look at what's happening around us on the issue of homelessness, right? I mean, how many of you thought that after you worked as hard as you did, and city council, repealed the criminal ordinances, that the fight was won? Did any of you think that? I am positive that the majority of you knew that would not be the case. And you know what? There may be another vote in City Hall on Thursday, and I assure you that that's not going to be the end either. But I know that we are going to win that struggle. And we are going to win that struggle only if tens of thousands, of hundreds of thousands of people continue to stay engaged in that fight every day until the fight really is won. So that is my view of, you know, social justice movements. I have seen, again, I have seen firsthand, you know, the power that all of us have, and I believe deeply in it. And I'm putting every dime I got in the bank on that notion, on the idea that if we can build a big enough army of regular people, of working class people who, you know, have been kicked aside, swept under the rug by this criminal justice system, that we can turn it on its head forever.
So we've got a small enough crowd that I think we could take a few from those of you in the room. You don't have to identify yourself because you don't live stream it or whatever. But I will be taking progressive staff if you raise your hand, which means that if you look like me, you go to the bottom of the line.
Hey.
Oh, wait. Two. All right. Two people. That's you.
My wife.
You don't have a beard.
Not yet. So you've been speaking a lot about ways to fix the system going forward, and pretrial is like probably the most important, the first step. But as a DA, you have a lot of power in working in post-conviction cases. So how willing are you to help in exoneration cases in post-conviction, whether it be Brady violations or the new evidence coming up, especially, you know, here in Travis County with the whole APD DNA lab shutting down? What would be your take, and how willing and how collaborative would you be to those groups that are working?
I'll try to be quick, Dominic, but so a couple of things. First of all, I am opposed to the death penalty and would never pursue it. But it doesn't stop there, because right now, right here in Travis County, there are cases that, as you know, because you work in post-conviction work, that are coming back through our court system for people who have been convicted and have in some instances been sentenced to death, where our district attorney's office is currently fighting to make sure that that sentence sticks, even though there may be DNA evidence or new evidence that really calls into question the validity of that conviction. And so the point I wanna make there is that in those instances, not only would I be opposed to seeking the death penalty in the first place, but I would also be opposed to using our office's power to keep death penalty sentences in place, if that makes sense. The second thing is, we should have a post-conviction review team here in Travis County that spends the resources to make sure that there is not a single innocent person sitting in our jail. And we should pursue that end with as much vigor as our office here in Travis County for the last 40 years has pursued sending people to jail in the first place. And so, without question, that has to be, you talked about the sort of back end. It feels like we're talking about a factory, but that is what our criminal justice system has become. And so I think that's a really key element to solving for our mass incarceration problem on the back end.
Yeah, so we don't typically see that too much in the county attorney's office, but I agree. I mean, if your interest is justice and doing the right thing, I mean, Jose hit the nail on the head. I mean, we can't be a barrier. We have to work in concert when injustice happens, whether it's 5 years ago or 4 years ago. It just has to be done. And I think with both Jose and myself, it's going to be a situation where you're not having to twist someone's arm to do the right thing. And so I'm looking forward to seeing Jose in office.
Hands back up. Go ahead.
My understanding is that for a lot of people that enter the criminal justice system, their first exposure to that is in school. And I don't know. First of all, there's a question of like how big of a problem is this in Travis County? Do you guys know? And the second question is, what can and will you guys do about it?
Yeah, so it's a great question. And I think in many places across the country, that really is the case. My sense is that here in Travis County, let me talk about this in a couple of ways. First of all, within AISD, I'm going to get in trouble here, but I think there are some people within AISD who believe very deeply in restorative justice practices, in sort of ending the school to prison pipeline. But then I think like when you start getting past the rhetoric and asking, well, what does that mean? How are you actually implementing that? My sense, and I want to be really clear, like I am not an expert on this. This is a sense I have talking to teachers, talking to our friends at Education Austin and talking to others, is that you've got a couple of campuses where they have really, in a systematic way, implemented restorative justice practices so that they're really working to build community with kids, to show them and teach them that they are loved and that they have value and that they have a path and a place, not to to be punitive as a first instinct. But I think the critique that I have heard is that that kind of value system and structure has not been implemented in a system-wide way across the district. And, I can imagine that that's a hard thing to do if you don't have a partner in the district attorney's office. I think first and foremost, I think the interest and the intent is there against the overwhelming majority of educators, people who have devoted their career to giving every kid a chance. And I think what's really important is for educators to have a partner in the district attorney's office that is going to work with them to implement a system-wide restorative justice program. And again, what we can do on our end, let me just make one more point about this, which is that the juvenile division shouldn't be, if I can use a baseball reference, it shouldn't be the minor league. It shouldn't be where you send brand new prosecutors to learn how to be prosecutors. It should be a place where you send seasoned attorneys who understand that that all people, especially young people, have value and who really have an interest in seeing justice be done, not trying to rack up their conviction rate. So that's another step that I think we have to take right away. I'll say it is one of the critiques I have heard of our district attorney's office, that right now the juvenile division is the place where they send the young attorneys. And I think that's something that's got to change.
So, the juvenile division is run in the district attorney office, but I'll just say we need more counselors in schools and less cops. I mean, that's probably one of the biggest problems we have. Calling the police for behavioral issues is the absolute wrong thing to do. And that's a big part of the school-to-prison pipeline. And the sooner that the decision-makers in AISD and just in schools in general come to that realization, the better off we're going to be to actually help kids deal with some of the issues they're going through.
I believe that you already got yours? Okay. Comrade
Cutoff, yeah. thanks, Dominic and Jose. I want to touch on civil asset forfeiture. That got Richard from our wonderful presentation. The impetus is a a previous candidate form where the current DA promoted her use of civil asset forfeiture to purchase phone cracking technology. So if you could touch on your use of civil asset forfeiture and also the role of the intersection of like privacy with investigations and probable cause and not stacking charges, et cetera, if that's an assessment.
Yeah, no, thank you. It's a fantastic question. So, I mean, you know, the notion behind civil asset forfeiture, what a mouthful, is the idea that, I mean, it's really like, I think, a system that was designed with drug kingpins in mind. And the basic notion is that, you know, you should not be able to accumulate mass amounts of wealth through illicit activity, go through a criminal system, and then hang on to all of your wealth. I think that's kind of, I mean, in very loose terms, the basic idea behind it. But when you look at what's happening here in Travis County, there's not been a lot of study on it, but there is some data. And I think there was a study done 2 or 3 years ago. And I think, you know, the median value of that was seized was something like $4,000 and below. Right, so a far cry from, you know, drug kingpins. And what that report showed is that far too many people who had their assets seized through this process were day laborers who get paid in cash and, you know, who don't have access to banking. They were people who had just cashed Social Security checks. And so it is a system that is currently, that is just another example, quite frankly, of how our criminal justice system really just weighs against working class people. And so what we will do when we win is that we will not seek forfeiture until a conviction has been obtained, to make sure that we get especially to eliminate cases of people having their assets seized before they even had their day in court. And I think more work needs to be done to think through who the targets of this process are. And so, I would love to think and talk more about this issue because it's a really important one.
So at the county attorney level, there's not a misdemeanor charge in Texas that would warrant civil asset forfeiture, and it's not going to happen in the county attorney's office. I mean, there's just no reason for it. It's been abused for way too long, and it's just not going to happen under my watch.
Okay. And we've cleared the room of questions.
So some of the things you talked about, programs like diversion programs, having prosecutors at magistration hearings, it costs a lot of money, particularly to have prosecutors at all the magistration hearings because they go 24/7. And some of the policies you mentioned are going to reduce costs, right? Like you just not prosecuting certain crimes, reducing jail costs. But that won't cover the full cost of all the plans that you want to roll out. How are you going to pay for all this stuff? Like, are you going to produce a budget that can show that you're going to actually carry through with these plans, particularly if you're, you know, are butting heads with judges or other policymakers who play a role in how the budget for the county is shaped? How are you going to be able to navigate those relationships while also having to deal with this, you know, millions and millions more dollars required for funding? How are you going to pay for it?
I mean, one thing I want to say about that and about that notion is, you know, nobody asks the question how we're going to come up with the money to have the highest incarceration rate in the country here in the state of Texas, right? No one, when legislators are seeking higher penalties and, you know, three strikes you're out and all of the failed policies that have got us to this point, the starting premise wasn't, can we really afford this? And so I just think, look, I think it's a fair question, and I think as you have identified, we have laid out a number of changes that we will make right off the bat that will reduce costs and that will make some of these resources available. But, you know, as I just think, that it is a mistake to put a price tag on our values and on implementing our values. The resources are there. I mean, the resources are there to lock up hundreds of thousands of people and, you know, keep them into their 90s every year. The resources are there for these kinds of common sense changes. You know, I just don't buy the notion that that 2018 was the first year that there was resources available for a public defender's office. I mean, and so this is about priorities, setting values, and aggressively pursuing them with the full support of an entire community. And if we do that, the resources are there.
So I'll say, in the county attorney's office, we're going to have to rotate attorneys in there. I mean, the plan is going to be to have less cases to prosecute due to all our new policies with marijuana, and that includes dangerous drugs, any other drug charges, sex work. We're going to have some free bodies to put in there. It's going to be different. Some prosecutors aren't going to like it, but we are going to have to rotate prosecutors in there to get it done. And I want to do it without requesting more money for additional prosecutors. I can't tell you right now what the budget's going to be for it, but it's something that if we care about it, if we're dedicated to fixing that problem at magistration, it's important enough to put bodies there. And for me, it is. You know, when you go to any given county court, how often do you see prosecutors in there? Not very often. They're in the back working on plea deals. It's very rare that you see prosecutors actually in the court doing work. So we've got the personnel. It's just a matter of how do we allocate it where it's needed. And for me, that's a priority at that point.
We have space till 9. Four follow-up questions.
Yeah.
So how do prosecutors at magistration? Let's say that the public defender office puts public defenders in magistration. Would you be willing to not have prosecutors at magistration and just let the public defenders do the advocating?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, so putting a prosecutor in the magistration's office is sort of a way to force the county to give more money to defense, to have them at that point. I would love it to have only defense attorneys there because I know where their heart is. I know that for misdemeanor cases, they're going to request zero cash bail. And if we're doing the same thing, that's redundant. You know, so for me, that would be the end goal, is to have defenders there and for the county to pour money where it's needed. And that's with the public defender's office.
Well, that's exactly where I was going to start. The goal here is to end a system where how much money you have determines whether you are sitting in jail or not. And if because of other steps we have taken, because we've stopped prosecuting a range of offenses, because there's a public defender showing up to magistration, because we have made clear to judges that we will be seeking folks to be released, you know, unless they're a danger to the community, that happens, and it's not necessary to have the DA's office actually show up and advocate that in every single case. Well, then it's not necessary. I mean, what is important is the outcome, not the process that gets us there. So if that's another way to save resources, then by all means.
Thank y'all for this talk and this town hall. Before everybody leaves, can the youth chapter take a photo with y'all?
Of course.
The hardest question of the night.
For people at home, reminder, we're going to be having debate on the floor for this on Tuesday at the Episcopal Church of the Resurrection. The Electoral Research Group will submit a report. We will also try to have the candidates available if we have any questions that can't be answered by the Electoral Research Group. The voting will be done online, so if you have not updated your membership, please do
membership
so.
Membership of what, Senator?
In DSA, this is for the DSA endorsement. You'll after the meeting, you'll be getting a link through your email, and you have 3 days to vote for or against endorsement.
So can I say something? So my personal cell phone number is on the campaign website, so if anyone has questions about anything, I'm available and I'm happy to answer any questions that you know may pop up later on down the line.